In this video, we quickly derive the formula for the energy stored in a basic parallel plate capacitor, and then we apply the formula to a simple example. Note that we're not considering the presence of a dielectric in between the plates. We're pretending it's just close enough to being a vacuum in between the plates right now. And I'll post a link to a video where we consider the presence of a dielectric as well. So just a little warning about this derivation. It does use calculus. Now, even if you're not in a calculus-based physics class, the calculus we use here is very accessible, and you might want to go ahead and watch it instead of skipping straight to the example. But if you've never seen any calculus, you might just want to skip to the example at the end. All right, so here's the basic setup for the derivation. I'm imagining starting with a discharged capacitor, and then I hook up to a power source and I start to pump charge from the negative plate to the positive plate. So I'm taking little charges dq, ripping them off the bottom plate and piling them up on the top plate. As this charge separation grows, the potential difference between the plates grows, and that's why I wrote it as V of Q. It's a function of how much charge is on there, and the bigger Q is, the bigger V is. Now, as this process continues, the potential energy increase of each little dQ is changing in size because the potential difference between the plates is getting bigger. And that's why we require calculus to do the derivation. It's this continuously changing quantity, and I have to add up all of these continuously changing quantities with an integral. All right, so one of the things I need to accomplish is to get the potential difference as a function of how much charge is on the plates right now. And to do that, I use our basic definition of capacitance. Capacitance is charge per volt, and that means the potential difference is going to be how much charge there is divided by the capacitance of this thing. Well, right now, the charge on the plates is little q, so little q over c. Then in order to get a handle on how much potential energy this little dq is getting on its way up from the negative to positive plates, I need to relate potential energy to potential difference. And I remember that potential is potential energy per unit charge. And this means the potential energy of a single charge is going to be q times v. And this in turn means that a change in potential energy for a charge is given by the size of the charge times the change in potential for that charge. So the change in potential in this case, I'm going from 0 to V. The change is V of Q. And so I end up with a tiny increment of increase in potential energy. I'm going to use the D notation to indicate that that's differential. So a little contribution to the total potential energy is given by the size of our charge, dQ, times the size of the voltage change for that charge, which is Q over C. Because that little dQ has gone from 0 to V, which was Q over C. So now I want to add up all of these little potential energy contributions, all the way from my first little dQ to the last one. And I have to have some final charge that I'm going to here, and I'm going to use a capital Q for that. My total potential energy is going to be the sum of all of the little contributions to potential energy. This is what an integral does. It's really just a continuous sum. And that's the integral of Q over C dQ. As I go all the way from my original charge of 0 to my final charge that I chose to call capital Q. As integrals go, this is very simple. So I'm going to get the C out of there, the 1 over C, have the integral from 0 to capital Q of Q dq. I just have to guess the antiderivative of q, which is 1 half q squared. And then I evaluate 1 over c times 1 half q squared from 0 to capital Q. When I plug in the lower limit for q, this expression vanishes, so that's gone. When I plug in the upper limit and then just move the constant out in front, I end up with a 1 half capital Q squared over c. So there's the total potential energy stored in a charged capacitor. Now it's really handy to be able to rework this formula in a couple other ways. So if I look at my basic definition of capacitance, C equals Q over V, I could turn that around and say that Q is CV, and I would get 1 half times CV quantity squared over C. One of the C's cancels, and I end up with 1 half CV squared. So there's another way of writing the energy. Finally, I could take that last expression of the total energy and replace C with Q over V. One of the V's cancels here, and I end up with 1 half QV. So it's three different flavors of how to measure the energy stored in a capacitor. In the first one, you don't need to know the voltage. The second one, you don't need to know the charge. And the third one, you don't need to know the capacitance. So I'll just go ahead and summarize right over here. The one that I actually have memorized is 1/2 CV squared, just because it feels so familiar. It's like 1/2 MV squared for kinetic energy. And then if I ever need to rework it in terms of other quantities, I just go ahead and do the substitution with the definition of capacitance. All right, so let's apply our new formulas to a simple example. I want the energy stored in a 1 picofarad capacitor charged to a potential difference of 6.0 volts. And so the energy stored in the capacitor is just 1/2 CV squared. That's 1/2 times 10 to the negative 12th farads for the capacitance. So pico means 10 to the negative 12th. Times my potential difference of 6 all squared. And I end up with 1.8 times 10 to the negative 11 joules. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.